Check 1 2, test 1 2, 1 2. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you all here this evening, and I'd like to also introduce our host for the evening, Patrick Larkin, well-respected senior counsel. Please put your hands together for Patrick.
Entitled, Is There a God? As you've heard, my name's Patrick Larkin and I'm your moderator for tonight. At the outset, I'd like to just say a few quick thank yous. First, to Joe Giannini, a Christian volunteer who was the instigator of this event. To Andrew Hunt and Carolyn Lerido of Warunga Adventist Television. And to Steve Maston and Morgan Storey of the Sydney Atheists for the invitation to be here and for putting on this event. They've put in a marvellous effort, which has led to this fabulous auditorium being completely sold out, as I understand it, some time ago. So I'd like you to briefly put your hands together for those people who've made it possible. I'd like to welcome the audience here, as well as everyone that's watching online. The format and the rules for tonight's debate have been agreed between the participants of both teams. Each speaker will speak for 10 minutes. There'll be a warning bell at 9 minutes, and I'm told that at 10 minutes and 15 seconds precisely, the sound will cease and a game over graphic will descend. At the conclusion of the debate, there will be a 15-minute break, and then there'll be a Q&A, and I'll say some more about the Q&A a little later. Now, to the audience, the debate, to paraphrase Joe Giannini's words, is to promote public discussion on the existence or otherwise of God. I'd ask the audience to allow a fair opportunity for all of the speakers to present their ideas without interjection. I'll say a little more about the rules of the Q&A a little later for the guidance of audience members who might wish to participate. At the conclusion of the Q&A, there'll be 5-minute closing statements from each of the teams. So without any further delay, let me introduce to you the first speaker for the affirmative side, Dr. Mark Harwood. Dr. Harwood earned qualifications in engineering and science at Sydney University and was employed in the aerospace industry for nearly 30 years. He had particular involvement in the design of Australia's national telecommunications satellite system. He is now employed by Creation Ministries International as a scientist, speaker, and writer. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Dr. Mark Harwood.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure addressing the question, does God exist, in the affirmative. As Christians, we believe that God does exist, and in particular that he has revealed himself through his word, the Bible. So it is the Bible that provides the principal framework by which we understand life and interpret the world around us. We believe the Bible is divinely inspired by the only eyewitness to the whole of history, God himself, and written down through the agency of the human authors. This is an entirely reasonable belief, since we find, among several other things, many examples of fulfilled prophecy written long before the events in question, which point to divine authorship, since man cannot reliably foretell the future. And secondly, an historical record that is consistent with what we observe in the physical world around us. The Bible reveals a perfect world in which there was no suffering, disease and death, and the first man and woman were made in God's image and given dominion over the creation. Adam and Eve disobeyed God, and as a direct consequence, sin and death became an integral part of what is now a fallen and broken world. Therefore, what we see around us is the imperfect remains of that once perfect creation, now in relentless decay. God judged the world with a global catastrophic flood in which all land-dwelling creatures with the breath of life in their nostrils died, except for Noah and his family and those with him on the ark. The stratified layers seen in massive sedimentary rock deposits all around the Earth are mute testimony to a past global watery catastrophe. And fourthly, in the greatest act of love the universe has ever seen, God sent his only Son, Jesus, to pay the price for our disobedience by dying on the cross. The historical event of his resurrection from the dead establishes that he is the Son of God. Therefore, salvation is available through faith in Christ alone. The atheist says there is no God, and based on this premise builds a worldview which seeks to account for the origin of the space-time matter universe, the origin of the first living self-replicating cell, and the diversity of living things we see today, all in naturalistic or materialistic terms. To establish a case, the atheist must explain the existence of the universe in terms of time and chance alone. So, beginning with radically different axioms or beliefs and building upon them with a set of presumably logical deductions, we each construct a worldview that is profoundly different from the other. The question is, which worldview best fits the observations we can make in the physical world, and which worldview is consistent with our experience as human beings? We contend that the biblical worldview is entirely consistent with what we observe, and that the evidence for the existence of God is unmistakable. In other words, we believe there is a God because of what we do know, rather than what we don't. But first, it's important to recognise a distinction within science. Operational science, based on observable, repeatable experiments, is the kind of science that has produced the wonders of our technological age and has rightly earned great respect in our community for scientists and engineers. Importantly, operational science does not conflict with the biblical account of origins. On the other hand, historical science seeks to reconstruct the unobserved past from observations made in the present, rather like the task of the forensic scientist at the scene of a crime. However, historical science is limited in its ability to reconstruct the unobserved past, since there may be more than one way the evidence can be interpreted, as in any good detective story. Therefore, especially with regards to origins, the scientist's belief system influences the interpretation of the data. It is only in this realm of historical science that any conflict with biblical history occurs, and so it becomes a conflict of belief systems rather than a conflict between science and the Bible per se. Operational science reveals a world that is consistent with the Bible's record of history. For example, the Bible speaks of a perfect creation, which is now subject to decay. So we would expect to see decline in living organisms over time, and indeed we do. Genetics has shown mutations relentlessly accumulate in the DNA of living organisms, from generation to generation, with a vast majority being near neutral, but nonetheless, on average, slightly deleterious. Genetic entropy, as this is called, leads overwhelmingly to loss and corruption of genetic information. But evolutionary biology, seeking to reconstruct the unobserved past, posits that organisms have progressed from simple to complex, with encyclopedic quantities of novel genetic information being added to the DNA through purely natural processes alone. However, genetic entropy flies in the face of evolutionary biology and shows that things are running down and not up. Natural selection cannot even preserve the genome, let alone improve it. As evolutionary geneticist Kondrashov said, why aren't we dead 100 times over? Operational science also leads to the conclusion that there has not been anywhere near enough time, even assuming the evolutionary timescales, to produce the staggering complexity we see in biological systems through natural processes alone. But it is much worse than that. By observing the rates of various physical processes and winding them backwards, the assumption of uniformitarianism, which has dominated geology for two centuries, we arrive at upper limits. We arrive at upper limits for the age of the Earth, nowhere near long enough for evolution to have taken place. I'm referring to things like the decay rate of the Earth's magnetic field, increasing ocean salinity, erosion of the continents, recession of the moon, tidal locking effects on the Earth, the human population of the Earth, ocean floor sediment accumulation, helium retention in zircons, and the list goes on. For more information on this topic of origins, I encourage you to visit creation.com, which has over 8,000 reference articles addressing both scientific and theological aspects of the origins debate. So operational or experimental science reveals a world that is consistent with the Bible's record of history. But there are other sound reasons to believe there is a God. Firstly, we observe that everything that has a beginning has a cause, an explanation for its beginning, an experiment repeated countless times in human history without exception. For instance, this building had a beginning. It had an architect and builder and is the result of intelligence applied to the task. That we now can't see the architect or builder doesn't mean there wasn't one. The universe had a beginning too, which follows directly from the laws of thermodynamics, and so it too must have had a cause. The cause is outside of the natural space-time-matter universe and so must be supernatural in the literal sense of the term, and also eternal, being outside of time. This supernatural eternal being is the Creator God. Secondly, we observe that the coded information in the DNA in living things, it is therefore reasonable to infer the existence of information, an information source or writer. Genetic information is not a result of the physics and chemistry of the molecules that make up the base pairs any more than the information in a book is the product of the paper and ink on which it is written. Rather, the information resides in the arrangement of the base pairs in the DNA, or the letters and words in a book. Moreover, before the information is written on the DNA or in a book, there has to be a pre-existing code or language such that the cellular machinery or the reader of the book can read it. Such non-material coded information can only arise in a mind. As Professor Paul Davies said, there is no known law of physics able to create information from nothing. Therefore, it is reasonable to conclude that just as the contents of a book arose in the mind of its author, so too the information in the DNA code arose in the mind of an intelligent creator. Finally, there is the moral argument for the existence of God. If God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist. Now, by objective moral values, I mean morality that is independent of people's opinions and yet is binding upon them whether people believe in them or not. However, objective moral values do exist. Things like love, compassion, justice are truly good, while rape and child abuse are truly evil. Therefore, God exists. Of course, this is not to suggest that atheists are not moral people, but rather they have no objective basis for their morality, but only the shifting sands of public opinion. Ladies and gentlemen, the atheist insists there is no God in spite of the evidence to the contrary, and I submit that is blind faith. But the Christian believes there is a God because of the evidence, and I submit that is a reasonable faith. Thank you.
The first speaker for the negative is Nick Sewel. Nick grew up in a Protestant family, going to a Sydney Anglican school. He had there several good biology teachers who promoted an interest in science. He developed an interest in politics and religion, which led him to explore psychology, the psychology of morality and belief during his studies at Sydney University. In the end, these exploits led him to questioning his faith in the same way that he would any others. These days, he tells us he relaxes by watching B-grade 80s sci-fi movies, reading UFO stories, and that relaxation is generally done over a glass of red wine. Would you please welcome Nick Sewel?
Thanks, Patrick. And thanks to Dr. Harwood for introducing the talk. One of the interesting things we find is if evolution could be proved completely wrong tomorrow using only scientific evidence, that would not be evidence for the existence of any God or necessarily any creative force. So I'm Nick Sewel, and I'm going to talk to you today about some optical illusions because I'm a big fan of them. So if we have a look at this one, we see on the left there's some parallel lines, but as they move over the center towards the right, it really looks like they start to go wonky and wavy. But if you see those lines and the way they go through the middle, you can see that they are actually running in parallel still. So our minds kind of deal with information trying to spot a pattern, because if there's a tiger that wants to eat you for lunch, you need to be able to spot that as part of the grasses of the savannah. So we don't necessarily consider the world objectively or rationally. We often see it through our own subjective filter. If we look at another image, these two images of the Leaning Tower of Pisa are actually exactly the same photo. But if the way that you look at it, it seems like they come from a different perspective, because that's the way that your mind expects to see them when there's two images next to each other. Often we can use kind of faulty logic, or we can have a problematic way of seeing the world because we interpret data and interpret evidence through our own filter. For instance, if I ask a question that says, a bat and a ball cost $1.10 in total, and the bat costs $1 more than the ball, how much does the ball cost? Many people will say 10 cents. And if I can just ask you, can you put up your hand if you think the answer is 10 cents? Okay, that's a few people. Thanks. So this is one of the questions that we come to where it seems like the obvious answer is 10 cents. But really, if the bat costs $1, the ball would cost 10 cents. But really, the bat costs $1 plus the price of the ball. And so the ball costs 5 cents. Sometimes you can follow a style of reasoning and logic where you haven't considered the question as fully as you should, and you haven't considered the way in which the world is. You might not have considered all of the evidence. So when we consider a question tonight, like, does God exist? I want to ask you, have you formed an opinion on this question, perhaps without considering all of the evidence? Have you read the Quran? Have you read the Hadiths? Have you considered whether or not Allah exists? It's possible that you haven't considered fully 100% of the evidence. And so I'd ask you, don't just try to think about this question tonight. Don't just try to take away one position. You can think about this at any time, and you can reverse your own position. It doesn't have to be one belief that you hold on to forever. So if we think about what's true and how you can actually understand that, we have to talk about this concept of epistemology. To me, faith is not actually a reliable epistemology. It's not a reliable way of knowing the things that you know. Hebrews 11:1 says, now the faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So by definition, faith is not really evidence for things where we have no evidence. It tries to present that evidence where we don't actually fully empirically know. And so we can look at things in the world about science. We can look at whether or not the universe appears to have a cause, but we can't really consider that question without actually kind of considering other ways in which you can think without faith. So if I was to go through and ask you, if your doctor worked in mysterious ways, would you still trust them? Sometimes it seems like God can operate outside the realm of human causality, and we still seem to give God a lot of trust, despite the fact that perhaps they don't deserve it. Or we may not have the same level of evidence that you might give to a doctor. So if God is all-knowing and all-loving, as Christians insist that he is, as well as being all-powerful, when we look at the world and we see evil in it, it seems like God does not intervene in the world. We see evidence recently of women who've been raped and kept inside a man's house for over 12 years. And it seems like God doesn't really directly intervene, even though people, once this rescue happened after 12 years, people said that was a miracle. So if God's not willing to intervene in the world, is he malevolent? Or if God's not able, or he's, you know, not willing, where does evil come from? We have to actually consider if God really is all-powerful and all-loving. Now, many Christians say that free will is kind of a response or a reason for this. So if we accept that there could be a creative force that created the entire earth, and if I got a bump on the head and accepted that, I still, you know, might come up with a strange idea about this God. And what if I said God is purely evil, vindictive, and malicious? What if that God wanted to create humans so that there would be a maximum of pain in the world, a maximum of suffering? We'd have to then consider kind of, would it make sense if you looked at hospitals in the world, if you looked at groups like Doctors Without Borders, would it make sense that given the amount of good there is in the world, the ability that humans have to care for each other, to love each other, to try and do good to other people, would that disprove the idea of an evil God? Many people kind of, if you look at your families, you see that you've been given children to take care of, to love, to help. And many people would look at that and then see that it seems like the evidence in the world for there being good suggests that an evil God couldn't exist. And I'd ask you, if that's the case, if it looks like the existence of good in the world presents a problem of good for an evil God, does the existence of evil in the world present a problem of evil for a maximally good God? Does it make sense that God could be perfectly good and want people to be loving and happy, but still allow evil, suffering, and death? Dr. Harwood says that if objective moral values exist, they can't exist without some God. But I would ask, if objective moral values do exist, are they apart from God himself as well? If something is commanded by God, is it a moral action because God commands it, or is it a moral action in and of itself? If a command can be given that would otherwise be considered objectively evil, if such objective moral values did exist, then it would seem that God is capable of commanding evil, which goes against the whole concept that he is maximally good, which many people want to insist on. And so when we consider any kinds of gods, and there are many, but if we consider the idea of Yahweh, the God of the Old Testament, in Numbers 31, he commands Moses to command his soldiers to kill every boy, every woman who's ever had sex, after they've already slaughtered many of these Midianite fighting men. Now, to me, this doesn't really seem like the actions of a maximally good God. How can this be considered moral? It's a world where allowing the slaughter, the rape of people, allowing women to be enslaved into sex slavery, the women who are the virgins, the 32,000 Midianite virgins captured, are counted as well as the 61,000 donkeys. It seems like this comes from a time in which men would fantasize about this type of thing and write about women as being like property in the same way that you would consider donkeys your property. It doesn't really seem to be objectively morally good. We have to consider, does this God really actually seem to be as fully good as we might like them to be? Does it actually pose the challenge that objective moral values might not exist? It might be that we've become more moral in the meantime. And let's consider another question. When we look at the International Space Station, we can see there's beautiful photographs that the International Space Station beams back down. So when you read the Bible often we find these things in the Old Testament that sound quite out of place, out of character, and not in line with modern morality. But many people say, look, you know, that doesn't sound like it's moral, so maybe we need to interpret that not literally. We might say that has a metaphor, maybe that didn't literally happen. When you look at a photograph from the ISS, you don't need to look at that photograph and say, some of this is literal and some of it's a metaphor, because you know that the whole photograph is literally true. We can trust that the ISS tells us what it shows us. We can trust that this is a beautiful photograph. Isaiah 40:22 says, God is the one who sits above the circle of the earth. We know that the earth is not a circle. We know that it is a sphere, and we can know that with a high level of accuracy because we can beam back images from the earth today. And I would argue that if you look at the beauty, the majesty of these photographs, I think we can live a better life, a more moral life, and a fulfilled life without belief in the Old Testament. Thank you.
The second speaker for the affirmative side is Professor John Ashton. Professor Ashton is a Chartered Fellow of the Royal Australian Chemical Institute and an adjunct professor of two universities, being Victoria University and RMIT University in Melbourne. He's edited or co-authored a number of books seeking to prove the existence of the Creator God of the Bible. His latest book is entitled Evolution Impossible, 12 Reasons Why Evolution Cannot Explain the Origin of Life. Would you please welcome Professor John Ashton.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's certainly an honour to be here. It's very interested in Nick's views, and the problem of evil is certainly a major problem that people have to grapple with. And I think that the Bible does explain what the issue is in terms of a great controversy between Christ and Satan. But that's a fairly deep topic, and maybe Sven will talk on this and reply to some of those issues. I work as a research scientist, and I'm very interested in experimental evidence and what we can know from that data. So that's what I'm going to focus on now. And perhaps let me explain some of this. When I finished university, one of the questions I asked myself was, is there a supreme being, God? Now, at the time, I had a job in a top chemistry research laboratory, working with scientists trained at Cambridge and Oxford and MIT in London. But one scientist stood out. He was a Christian. He tried to witness to me. He loaned me the book Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis, which I read. So one day I decided to pray a prayer, and I prayed my first prayer. I prayed that if I won the Toxide Research Fellowship, which at the time, 1970, was the highest paying, most prestigious chemistry scholarship offered in Australia, I would start going to church and I'd buy a Bible and read it. Well, I won that scholarship, so I went out and I bought a Bible, started to read it, and I started going to church. And I began to meet other people who had specific answers to prayer and had miracles in their life. I found that the Bible also gave accounts of answers to prayer, fulfilled prophecy, public miracles, and so forth. And I came to believe in God, and specifically that Jesus, with Jesus as God my Saviour, and began to experience an inner change for the better, and as well as many specific answers to prayer. So these experiences are very real to me, and so God is very real. Now, later I wrote to a number of Christian university professors around the world asking why they believed in answers to prayer and miracles, and some of their responses became the book On the Seventh Day. That's the first book that I wrote, well, not the first one, an early one. So that one there is another book. So these highly educated professional researchers describe subjective evidence for a real personal supernatural being, God of the Bible. There are literally thousands of similar accounts of answers to prayer and witness miracles in both Christian and secular literature, which provide a massive amount of consistent subjective evidence for the existence of God. However, there's also objective evidence. Firstly, we observe the existence of the universe and ourselves. Now, a number of theories have been proposed to explain the origin of the universe: Big Bang theory, string theory, multiple universe theory, etc. But there are major problems with all these theories. Even the commonly touted Big Bang theory requires a singularity, a one-off something, hypothetical inflation, as well as imaginary entities such as dark matter and dark energy and so forth. Now, none of these theories offer an explanation of how the first matter or energy came into existence, or how the precise mathematical laws of physics and chemistry which constrain matter and energy came to be. There's a law of physics that while matter can be converted into energy and vice versa, according to E equals mc squared, matter and energy cannot be created or destroyed by natural physical processes. Since we observe matter and energy to exist, they must have been created by a supernatural, non-physical, non-natural process. The Bible explains that matter and energy were created from nothing by a self-existing, supernatural God outside space and time, and that we can know. This account, in my view, best fits the observed data. The second objective evidence is the observation that we and other things are alive. However, we observe that life always comes from life. In fact, when Jesus arose from the dead, we call that a miracle, because we know that non-living things cannot become alive by natural processes. Also, from a theory of origins perspective, there's no viable mechanism which can explain how the first living cell could form. Living cells are just incredibly complex biochemical factories. In fact, we know that it is biochemically impossible now. And why this is so is explained by biochemists John Marcus and George Jather in my book In 6 Days, Why 50 Scientists Choose to Believe in Creation. Whoops, we've gone too far. For the first life to form, we have to produce massive biopolymers. However, these giant types of molecules could not naturally form in an aqueous environment, according to Le Chatelier's principle. Also, DNA is a huge molecule encoding massive amounts of information, and this has to form. For example, the simplest free bacterium has a DNA code containing 580,000 base components. When we get to a little worm, 97 million bases, a mouse, 2.6 billion bases. However, there is no known mechanism or experiment that demonstrates how natural processes could produce such a code. As the eminent biologist Dr. Eugene Cunin at the US National Center for Biotechnology and Information, in his 2009 paper entitled The Origin and Evolution of the Genetic Code, The Universal Enigma, points out, his quote, "Indeed, it stands to reason that any scenario of the code origin and evolution will remain vacuous if not combined with an understanding of the origin of the coding principle itself and the translation system that embodies it. At the heart of this problem is a dreary, vicious circle. What would be the selective force behind the evolution of extremely complex translation system before there were functional proteins? And of course, there could be no proteins without a sufficiently effective translation system. A variety of hypotheses have been proposed in the attempts to break the circle, but so far none of these seem to be sufficiently coherent or enjoy sufficient support to claim the status of a real theory." End of quote. There's over 100 million different complex codes have existed, responsible for all the different species that have existed. It's absolutely impossible for these 100 million different highly complex codes to have arisen by chance. So science has no naturalistic explanation for the origin of DNA code. Rather, it constitutes obvious evidence of amazing intelligent design. But there's more. Having DNA code doesn't make something alive. Scientists can take a dead bacteria that have all their DNA intact, can't make them alive. To make a cell alive, one would have to set hundreds of biochemical reactions in a state of disequilibrium at just the right concentration simultaneously. That is, chemical A would have to be set at just the right concentration to make B. It has to be set just the right concentration to make C, for hundreds of reactions simultaneously, which is impossible to do by any known technology, let alone happen naturally. So from our scientific knowledge, it is impossible for life to start by some natural process, yet we observe life. And I give more details in this or in the book Evolution Impossible. The third objective evidence is the observation that we have a mind. We think thoughts. We create ideas. We have an individual will. We wake up and we think, I will get out of bed. And those thoughts activate nerve impulses, which in turn activate muscles, and we get up. Now, what constitutes your mind or your thoughts? Your brain is a physical entity made up of chemical molecules and has mass and occupies space. But the mind and thoughts are non-material. Your thoughts don't have mass. They don't occupy cubic centimetres of space. Yet your non-material thoughts serve to affect nerve impulses and move your body to create something that we would call intelligent design. That is non-random, has never existed before. A poem, a mobile phone, an army tank, a light bulb, a sculpture. Handel's thoughts created the amazing piece of music Messiah. John Utzon's thoughts became the design that's now the Sydney Opera House. But where do thoughts and mind originate? How did a mind and thought become part of life? The brain as physical incorporates chemical processes that obey chemical laws that do not encode intelligence or willpower. As the eminent New York University professor of philosophy Thomas Nagel argues in his recent book Mind and the Cosmos, why the materialist neo-Darwinian conception of nature is almost certainly false, evolution cannot explain the origin of the mind. If human thoughts can cause physical actions in the human body, then God's thoughts can cause the existence of the universe and us. It follows that just as artifacts are evidence of human activity, the universe is evidence of God's existence. When we consider the big picture, science cannot explain our existence. Rather, the overwhelming evidence for design in the universe and in our planet and living things all point to a non-material, supernatural, intelligent designer and creator whose thoughts initiated our existence, our universe, our planet, and life. This scenario is consistent with our three objective observations. The Creator God scenario is also consistent with the biblical account and many of the supernatural miracles and answers to prayer experiences reported in the Christian literature. Therefore, on the basis of the above arguments, I propose that we have consistent evidence from both science and personal experience for the existence of God. Now, an atheist may be tempted to argue that in the future we will discover the seemingly impossible mechanisms to explain the universe, life and mind, to which I would argue that in the future we will see God, because that is predicted in the Bible. Professor J.B. Payne, who earned his doctorate at Princeton Theological Seminary, notes in his 1973 Encyclopedia of Biblical Prophecy that there were 737 events predicted in the Bible, with the majority clearly fulfilled. So clearly, your chances of seeing God in the future are infinitely greater than the chances that science will discover a process that explains our existence. So to me, it's very clear that the creator of the Bible, exists as God. Thank you.
The second speaker for the negative team is Morgan Storey. Morgan was raised a Catholic and, so he says, had a lot of respect for the church and enjoyed his time there. He went through the Catholic education system and received a good education and learned a passion for science, including from some priests and brothers, and especially from a former head of ANSTO, the Australian Nuclear Science and Technology Organisation. That prompted a lifelong thirst for knowledge in all areas of science, and he became a regular reader. These days, he is an IT professional performing security functions for a large Australian company. During his studies, he was taught comparative religion and began exploring the differences between faiths. That began a questioning of Catholicism and other religions. He explored other religions and other spiritual traditions, but found them all to fall down from what he regarded as questions of faith and magical thinking. These days, his hobby is science and skeptical thought. That ultimately led him to his deconversion. He joined the Sydney Atheists group in 2010 and was elected vice president at the start of this year. The father of two wonderful kids, married to his wife, a natural skeptic. Could I please introduce Morgan Storey?
Thank you for the introduction. I'm just quickly going to answer a couple of the questions. If you look on our website, we've actually answered all of your questions. So, but anyway, abiogenesis, etc. Anything that's said here should not be taken as fact. Anything even I say you shouldn't take as fact. Go away and look into it yourself. Think it through carefully. As the previous speaker from Sydney Atheist, Nick, said, even if evolution were proved wrong tomorrow, it doesn't prove that God exists, let alone the all-powerful, omnipotent creator God, Uhuru Mazda, the god of Zoroastrianism, which was from 500 CE, or even the Abrahamic God of Christianity, Judaism and Islam. But my opponents will already cast aspersions on evolution as though some piece of missing knowledge or some piece they don't understand is cause to throw the whole lot of evolutionary science in the bin. I could say the same of an oft misrepresented holy book that some people hold dear, but I don't, and a lot of atheists don't, including Richard Dawkins. So here again are some references for our opponents and for the audience at large to look into why creationism is wrong and why evolution is right. I'm not going to touch much on science because I am not a scientist. I do this only as a hobby. But if you look at these, you'll get some information. People have claimed in the past that science simply attempts to disprove the Bible, and this is not true. Science only cares about what is true. Science is not a belief system, despite what our opponents say. Real science comes from not holding any preconceptions. Things happen that scientists don't actually expect or even want. The mark of real science is allowing the evidence to lead the way, not the other way around, no matter how comforting or how happy your preconceived ideas make you feel. You must be willing to discard these ideas should the evidence point in a different direction. Science has done this. Prior to Pasteur, scientists believed in the spontaneous generation of life, mice forming in boxes of rags. Prior to Hubble, we thought the same of galaxies and that the universe was in a steady state. I'm willing to entertain the idea of a God if the evidence leads that way. I even entertain it myself from time to time, just as a way of growth. I think you need to entertain conflicting ideas to grow. It can be easily demonstrated that an argument can fall down on assumptions that prop them up, assumptions that shouldn't be made unless there's evidence to support them. As you can see here in assumption one, a God of some kind exists. You're making that assumption, but you're jumping straight to assumption four. Jesus of the Bible exists and was the Son of God. You can't jump to that until you prove assumption one. And that hasn't been proved for 2,000 years, so I don't think it's going to be done here tonight. The argument from design, as they have basically put it, states that the universe and life appears designed. How do we know? Do we have another universe to compare it to, one that was designed or one that wasn't, for that matter? Or do we think it's designed because we just grew up in it? We evolved within the universe and everything looks designed because it looks like us. It looks evolved. Could it be that the design of the universe appears designed because it's simply so massive? If you look at this observable universe picture here, that's roughly 500 billion galaxies. That's our little galaxy in the corner of a small arm. That only contains anywhere between 200 and 400 billion stars. 50 billion of those solar systems possibly could contain life. They're in the habitable zone. Mark Harwood actually points this out in one of his videos. The argument that there is design in the rules of the universe, which was brought up, is simply false. We know that the laws could have been different. We may have actually had a better universe. They could have been different. We could have had a worse universe. We don't know. We don't have another universe to test this hypothesis out on. The other counters to the argument from design come from the negative design that we see in the universe. The opposition have already tried to counter this by saying that we live in a fallen world. But if God was all-knowing and he knew Eve was going to eat from the tree and cause us to all be damned, wouldn't he have stopped it? Wouldn't he have actually gone out of his way to stop that? What would any of us here in the audience do today if we knew our child was going to disobey us and touch a PowerPoint? Would we stop them or let them do it and kill themselves? No, we'd probably put a protection on that PowerPoint so they wouldn't electrocute themselves. I think it's going a bit overboard to damn us all unless we accept his son. But there are lots of examples of this negative design. There's the human heart that only has three arteries to supply it with oxygen, which is perfectly fine if you're a fish, but not if you're an upright walking mammal such as ourselves. Teeth, we've only got two sets that are supposed to last us 80 years. Why do sharks have 50 sets? They seem to be a little bit more blessed dentistarily than we are. Not to mention the laryngeal nerve that some of you may have heard of, which passes from the brain to the larynx to control the muscles. Unfortunately, it passes below the heart, which in fish and humans isn't that bad of a design, but in giraffes, it's kind of a problem. It's an 18-foot detour for them, which is why you don't actually hear them bray very often. The other argument I've heard them use already is the universe is really not designed for us. If you look up there, those are all of the objects, extra solar objects in our solar system. The red ones have a likelihood of hitting us within the next, I think, 50,000 years. The green ones, no, not very likely, but that's not very good for design, at least in our solar system. If the universe was designed for us, we wouldn't have things like over here. These are stars orbiting a black hole in Sagittarius A. If we were anywhere near this, life would be impossible. There'd be too much radiation. So there's radiation, there's neutron stars, and then the background of space, which is a minus 270 degrees Celsius, 454 for anyone in America, Fahrenheit, that anyone's watching it. Not to mention the trillions of wandering asteroids we saw before, comets and planets the size of Jupiter ready to wipe us out. The next argument they touched on was the Kalam cosmological argument. It's an interesting one, and they attempt to baffle you with the steps that you can see here. Usually step one is everything that has a beginning of its existence has a cause of its existence. This one's also changed sometimes to the more confusing one, there can be no infinities. The first phrasing that you saw there was a bit of begging the question. We don't know for a fact that the universe had a beginning, which also cuts down step two. We know that the Big Bang, well, we're fairly sure that the Big Bang happened, but it could have just been the start of a new era for the universe. Modern science also talks about virtual particles. that do begin to exist with no cause whatsoever. And these have been observed in experiments such as the Casimir effect and Hawking's experiments to do with black holes. And there's actually another more recent one with mirrors, but I won't go into that. You can look it up. But so these pop into and out of existence all the time. The issue with rephrasing and saying that that there can be no infinities and that God is the infinity is that you have to give him lots of infinite qualities. He has to be infinitely powerful. He has to be infinitely intelligent. He has to be infinitely knowing. He has to be infinite in space, which makes him infinitely complex. And you also make him exist for an infinite amount of time before the universe even started. Why not simply save some infinities and just say the universe existed forever? That's the simplest answer after all. The all-powerful God that is defined by most Christians has a lot of logical paradoxes. And all of us have probably heard the one from our children, which is, can God, in his all-powerfulness, create a rock he can't lift? Can God do evil? If he can't, then by definition, he's not all-powerful. If God is all-powerful but not part of space and time, then by definition, he's outside of it, and he can't change anything inside of it without leaving evidence behind, evidence which we would find. And no, none has been presented in the last 2,000 years, so no Nobel Prize has been awarded for that. He cannot change the effect if he doesn't exist within time, because he doesn't have any time to affect his thought processes for cause and effect. So if he exists outside of time, then we have a problem. Does God know everything? How can he? Sorry, I was actually asked for that slide to be removed. That's all right. How can he? Certainly, he can search his memory and define and determine that everything he knows about completely. But as a politician says when they're defining risk, he doesn't know about the unknown unknowns. How can he? He can't know about subjects he doesn't actually know about. Lastly, occasionally both sides will create a straw man, and I've already heard one today on about evolution. And unfortunately, we don't necessarily hold to some of these beliefs that are being brought up. And I hope we haven't created any straw men when talking about your beliefs. And definitely, this is not just Christianity, obviously. We're all from Christian faith, so we know that. But finally, to paraphrase Carl Sagan, more humble and, I think, truer to consider him created from animals, where Johnny-come-latelys arriving only a fraction of the 4.5 billion years the Earth has been around. We live in the cosmic boondocks, a small arm of the galaxy in the outer reaches of a massive galactic cluster. Apes are our cousins. Oop, it's not working now. Apes are our cousins. Our thoughts and feelings are not fully under our own control, even though we long to be here for a purpose, even though despite much self-deception, none is evident. We long for a parent to care for us, to forgive us our errors, and to save us from our childish mistakes. But knowledge is preferable to ignorance. Better by far to embrace the hard truth than a reassuring fable. Modern science has been a voyage into the unknown with a lesson in humility waiting at every stop. Our common sense intuitions can be mistaken. Our preferences don't count. We do not live in a privileged reference frame. If we crave some cosmic purpose, let us find for ourselves a worthy goal. Let us not waste our precious time on this planet with claims that there are no evidence, however reassuring. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the final speaker for the affirmative team is Dr. Sven Ostring. Dr. Ostring completed his doctorate in computer networking at the University of Canterbury in Christchurch, New Zealand, and subsequently took up a postdoctoral research position in a computer laboratory at Cambridge. After exploring Christian apologetics, he decided to pursue his interest in theology and enrolled in a graduate diploma in theology at Avondale College in New South Wales. At that time, he was elected president of the National Adventists Students Association. Having completed his theological studies, he accepted an invitation to develop a ministry in the university for the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Western Australia. He's an advisor for the Adventist Students Association and the multi-faith officer at Curtin University. He tells us he enjoys playing the violin in the Fremantle Symphony Orchestra and racing his bike and spending time with his wife and their two children. Please welcome Dr. Ostring.
Well, good evening. For me, the question of whether there's evidence that God exists is one of great personal significance. I was living at Cambridge at the time, as Patrick mentioned, the place where Isaac Newton wrote his Principia Mathematica, where you can race around the courtyard of Trinity College in a reenactment of an early scene in Chariots of Fire and watch an outdoor performance of Midsummer Night's Dream. But the question of God's existence did not hit me with an apple, though, but with rather a few slices of real pizza. I arrived home to my shared accommodation to find my housemate Jane talking with her lawyer friend, Nicole, and they invited me to join them in finishing off their pizza, to which I readily agreed. 20 minutes later, Nicole turned to me and asked me the question that I'll never forget. Where is the evidence that God exists? That simple question became the catalyst that changed my whole direction in life. And as I started exploring if there are any reasons why an intelligent postdoctoral researcher could believe in God, I came just across some very powerful reasons that you and I can confidently believe in the existence of God. Now, recent discoveries in science regarding expansion of the universe have demonstrated that both science and the Bible agree that the universe had a beginning. Now, since experience has shown us that whatever begins to exist must have a cause, this points to the reality that God exists as the ultimate cause of the universe. Now, just in response to Morgan, he may not be aware of a paper written in 2003 by three leading scientists, Evan Bord, Alan Guth, and also Alexander Vilkanen, who were able to prove that any universe that has on average been expanding throughout its history cannot be finite in its past, but must have a finite space-time boundary. So the universe does have a beginning. Now Morgan said that, well, what about the quantum physics? You have these particles popping into reality. But the issue here is that they're not popping into reality out of nothing. They're popping into reality from within a vacuum. So the thing is that for a vacuum is not just nothing. It actually has a physical space structure to it, a physical structure to it. It also has a sea of fluctuating energy. And so particles appear as energy is converted into mass. So particles do not appear out of literally nothing in quantum physics. The other thing, which is amazing discovery in science, is that the universe is fine-tuned for the existence of life. And there are a number of physical constants in the laws of the universe which scientists have discovered that need to be finely tuned for us to be here. And this points to the reality that God intentionally created this universe for us to exist. In fact, when the late Christopher Hitchens was asked by Pastor Douglas Wilson which reason for the existence of God he found the most thought-provoking, Christopher Hitchens said that it was the fine-tuning of the universe that really made him stop and think. Now, the atheist may respond by saying, well, we live in a multiverse with many different universes, and it so happens to be that we are in this universe. The problem is there's no physical evidence for this multiverse. And secondly, we would need a universe generator which would be able to vary all of these physical parameters to ensure that our universe exists. Not only this, the fact that our universe is expanding and also the multiverse would be expanding as well goes back to the issue that the multiverse had a beginning, so the probability that our universe exists and we live in it is actually very small. So using Occam's razor, it's simpler to conclude that God intentionally designed this universe for us to exist. The next step is the rationality of the human mind, which John actually also referred to as well. The rationality of the human mind also points to God as the rational cause of our own intelligence. Now, if God does not exist and our minds have been produced by naturalistic chemical processes, then as both Charles Darwin and C.S. Lewis observed, we'd have no reason to trust our cognitive faculties. Hence, naturalism is fundamentally self-refuting. It's contradictory. And we have no reason to believe that atheism is true. Now, the atheist might respond by saying, well, evolution has shown that human rationality is a product of natural selection, which has provided us with this significant survival benefit. Here, they would fail to understand the difference between a human faculty being shaped for survival as opposed to being shaped to discern what is true. If our cognitive faculties have evolved naturalistically, then these faculties are effective for our survival. So that the atheist might be very good at finding food, being able to run away from predators, being able to find a good reproductive partner, all of the things which are involved in survival. But there's no reason to believe that we'd be able to understand the far reaches of science, cosmology, metaphysics, theoretical physics, particle physics, and things like this. This means that believing in naturalistic evolution of the mind is self-refuting. We have no reason to believe in evolution or naturalism under this framework. Consequently, we are warranted to believe that God is the origin of our human intelligence and God exists. The fourth reason for believing in the existence of God is the existence of objective moral values and duties, as Mark has already pointed out. If God does not exist, then objective moral values and duties do not exist. Now, here the atheist side have referred to two things. They have referred to the problem of suffering and also Old Testament morality. And let me acknowledge, first of all, the problem of suffering is very real. It's a very real issue for each one of us, whether we're atheists or whether we're Christian or whether we believe in God at all. The problem here is that how can you determine if suffering is truly evil if you don't have objective moral values? And as Richard Dawkins said, this universe is exactly as we would expect to find it, with no foundation, no design, no good, no evil, just blind, pitiless indifference. So basically, the atheists need objective morality to actually demonstrate that suffering is really evil and the issues in the Old Testament are really something we need to develop from. And that is literally evidence for God. So thank you very much to the atheist side. Now, the greatest Christian evidence, and this is very important, the greatest Christian evidence, and this is why you and I sitting here today can believe in the existence of God, is the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Taking all of the historical material about Jesus, including all of the biblical sources, as well as the Jewish and Roman sources, ancient historians have reached a consensus that Jesus was a real historical person who'd had a very distinctive vision of the kingdom of God. To demonstrate what the kingdom of God was like, Jesus carried out this ministry of teaching, miraculous healing, and casting out of demons. Now, some atheists, and there may be some here tonight, have proposed that Jesus was not actually a real historical person, but rather as a mythical person, which was invented by Christians, borrowing from pagan myths. Now, in a public dialogue that Professor Richard Dawkins had with Professor John Lennox at the Oxford University Museum of Natural History, Professor Lennox said to Dawkins, "Reading your book, The God Delusion, you say that it is under scholarly dispute amongst historians that Jesus actually existed. Why would you write something like that?" To which later Dawkins responded, "I take that back. Jesus existed." So since Dawkins, as one of the leaders of the New Atheism movement, did a significant change in tack that night on the historicity of Jesus, I'm very happy to permit U-turns for any person here tonight that does not believe that Jesus is a real person. You know, when you study these pagan myths more carefully, there are significant differences between these myths and the life of Jesus become apparent. They're completely different when you read these legendary stories. Secondly, what often mythicists do is they actually use Christian terminology when they're telling the story. So it sounds very Christian. But the problem, of course, in the original stories, it was totally different. The other problem with this theory is that most of the narratives, sources that we have for these myths actually come from the 2nd and 3rd century AD. The issue, of course, is that we have the letters of Paul, we have the book of Acts, we have the Josephus, we have all of the Gospels. All of the evidence is for Jesus existing in the 1st century. So if there's any borrowing going to occur, it's from pagan sources borrowing from Christian material. As Professor Gerald has commented, this type of surface-level application of analogous symbolism is a case of parallelomania, which exaggerate the importance of trifling resemblances. We can agree with Professor James Dunn's conclusion that the mythical Jesus is a thoroughly dead thesis. So tonight we're looking at the resurrection of Jesus, we've looked at the origin of the universe, the fine-tuning of the universe, the rationality of the human mind. Therefore, it's because of the evidence that we have that we can believe that God exists.
The final speaker for the negative team is Alaric Goldkuhl. Alaric converted to Christianity at the age of 18, and he tells us that he very quickly became one of those annoying Christians that endlessly quotes Bible passages, scripture line by verse. He'd read the Bible from cover to cover at least once a year, and when he wasn't reading the Bible, he tells us, he'd be listening to tape sermons or reading various Christian texts or self-help books. At the age of 22, he began a Bachelor of Arts at the Australian Catholic University, studying a double major in mathematics and theology. Exposed, so he says, to the scholarship of the last few centuries of biblical criticism, he began to question his beliefs and his understanding of the Bible. Knowing how and why the Bible was put together and how Christianity began deeply challenged his beliefs. And by the age of 26, he no longer counted himself as a Christian. He continued to explore other religions and practices, continuing his quest to become more Christ-like, and eventually immersed himself in Buddhist philosophy and practice. But by the time Alaric had reached his 30s, he'd rejected the last vestige of Christianity that was left, namely his belief in God. As an atheist, he continues to be passionately interested in what he describes as aligning his beliefs as best as they can, as he can, with reality, cultivating a meticulous scepticism in all areas of his life. For this reason, he cherishes disillusionment. He's currently studying a Diploma of Education at Macquarie University. Please welcome Alaric Goldkuhl.
Thank you very much. How do we know what is true or what is real as opposed to what is not? This is what the core of this debate is all about. I want to continue now with our exploration of the ways in which human cognition fails us in coming to sound, reasonable conclusions. Perhaps the most leading of these is our tendency for what's called motivated thinking. Emotions hold primacy over our cognitive functions, not so rational after all. We're therefore good at finding ways to believe what we want to believe, and it takes a great deal of conscious effort to keep searching for truth, even when it might not be what we want to believe in. Knowing we all have this flaw in our thinking, if we care about believing in what is true, we need to examine the decisions we have made through emotion with light of reason. The decision to convert to Christianity is one such emotionally driven decision, which says nothing whatsoever about whether Christianity is true or not, only that anything accepted uncritically should be re-examined as it may have been in error. Think about the reason why you became a Christian, and you will have a reason why you embraced it, some argument you found convincing at the time. What I'm suggesting is that your acceptance of that reason as sufficient was driven by an underlying emotional need. It was grasping for anything that would allow you to justify to yourself why you did so. Try to cast your mind back to that time in your life and think about the emotional motivations you might have had. In my case, at the age of 18, I had very low self-esteem after a pretty rough childhood, and the lure of a supportive and accepting community which also offered a deep sense of belonging, was what was driving me. I accepted a very weak and poorly reasoned argument as my reason for converting. I continued on for many years, unwavering in faith and zeal, until I began studying theology at university. When I tell people this, that it was my degree in theology which caused me to let go of Christianity, they say, "How? Religions are like sausages," I tell them. "Once you know how they are made, you don't want to eat them anymore." It was a hard road, but worth it in the end. After years of heated arguments with lecturers, it got to a stage in my second year where the sheer weight of evidence against my beliefs was overwhelming. The Bible is not what it seems at all. Learning, for example, that the four Gospels were all written anonymously and were only named Matthew, Mark, Luke and John by Irenaeus in about 180 CE, or that Mark, was the first Gospel, was written 30 to 40 years after Jesus had supposedly died. These are historical facts that each cast a tiny doubt. Together, they cause grave doubts. I was losing my faith, which was my salvation, and it was terrifying. What if it was the devil leading me astray from God's true path? This activated another cognitive error within the human brain. When we are fearful, it overrides our ability to reason. When we are fearful, our minds are directed towards anything which might save us from the thing that we're fearful of. I remember vividly the moment it all broke open. It was a still small voice within me, which at the time I assumed was the Holy Spirit, because that's what you always assume when you're a Christian. It said, paraphrasing, "How far are you willing to go to find the truth? How much are you willing to risk? If you really have faith and keep seeking truth honestly, won't it lead back to God if he's the source of truth?" That gave me the courage to question my faith in earnest. I had to rethink everything that I had been basing my life on. I had to re-examine all my beliefs and try to work out what was true. It was not an easy thing. But how do we decide that? What is true? What I discovered was to be vitally important was to develop ways to test for truth, an effective epistemology. I had to learn the rules of reason and evidence and learn about the weaknesses in human thinking which would lead to error, so that I might be able to keep my eye on my thinking and know when I needed to be especially careful. An important part of an effective epistemology is having the humility to accept the limits of your own knowledge. There are things we just cannot possibly know because they cannot be tested. In these cases, we need to be honest with ourselves and admit that we don't know. For example, the still small voice I spoke of. If a thought arises in my head, how could I possibly know that it came from God? Even if I accept completely the Christian worldview that God and the devil exist and can communicate to me telepathically, how could I possibly know that they had? Or that the thought didn't simply arise from my own subconscious, like any other thought. There's no way to test for the source. I can't tune in to the signal to verify that it's coming from somewhere external. And even if I could verify that it was an external source, how could I know that it was coming from God or from the devil? By faith, but believing it's from God doesn't change its source, does it? And this brings me to the core of why Christians would accept such things so uncritically. Faith. As Nick said, it is defined in Hebrews 11:1 as the evidence of things not seen. In other words, if I believe something which is intangible to my senses, then that belief is evidence that the claim is true. Is it really, though? If I believe that Thor exists, then he does. If I believe that Joseph Smith really did read holy golden plates with magical glasses, then he did. You were taught as Christians that your faith is a virtue, the source of your salvation, and a wondrous, miraculous thing. This prevents you from seeing it for what it really is. Faith is the ultimate in failed epistemology. The rest of us non-religious types know this phenomenon by a different word. We call it gullibility. To show you how indistinguishable from gullibility it is, I have in my pocket some magical beans, which will grant you three wishes. They have a direct connection to a source of omnipotent power, so the wishes able to be granted are truly unlimited. I will sell you these beans right now for only $500. All you need is a tiny bit of faith and all your wishes can come true. How would you describe the person who bought my beans for $500? A man of faith? No, just gullible. You would only consider it faith if I was a pastor or a priest or a rabbi or an imam. What does that say about the word faith? The best we could say it is the word we substitute for gullibility, so religious people don't have to think too much about what they believe. The word faith is a disguise we put on gullibility, so we can pretend it is a virtue instead of a dangerous vice, a laziness of thinking which leads to faulty and unsubstantiated beliefs. There is zero evidence that God exists. If faith is your evidence, then it can be evidence for anything, absolutely anything, including magical beans. My hope tonight is that everyone here will go home with a single question tattooed on their brains. How do I know? How do I know that this thing that I believe in is true? Work out your epistemology and apply it, and I'll see you all at the next Atheist Meetup. Thanks for listening.
Thank you, Alaric. Morgan observed that we don't have another universe to conduct tests upon. I'm not so sure that the ideas presented by these two teams aren't really universes apart. But nevertheless, the ideas have been laid out for our audiences, both here and online. We're going to have a little break. The format has had to alter a little bit. I'm told that the caterers have been late in arriving. And hence what we'll do is we'll just have a 5-minute break and move straight to the Q&A, and the refreshments will be provided at the end of the evening. So could you all make sure that you're back here in 5 minutes and we'll be ready to go with the Q&A. I need the run sheet. 9 o'clock. Can I ask you this? What happens if the Q&A is lagging a little bit? What happens if it's lagging in terms of momentum within the audience, etc.? I won't if it's going well. Ladies and gentlemen, we've now moved to our Q&A segment this evening. And I wanted to say a few things about the rules. The system will be that each of the teams has submitted to me two questions for each other, and I will read the first question from the affirmative team for the negative team, and then proceed with the opposite way around. Thereafter, there will be an opportunity for people who want to ask questions to come down to the microphone beside me and ask questions. So you can, in fact, begin to line up if you wish to fairly shortly. There are some rules that the teams, as I say, have agreed before the debate. The opportunity, as I say, the purpose of this debate is to promote an exchange of ideas and to test ideas. Therefore, what we would like from questioners is a question, not a speech. I don't want to have to solemnly look at that camera and say, I'll take that as a comment. What we want are questions that are directed to one or other teams or one of the speakers, but that are designed to elucidate the thinking of the speakers or designed to test the thinking of the speakers. The other rule that is of importance is that though it is reasonable, more than reasonable, the purpose of this debate is to test ideas. We want the questions asked in a reasonably civil manner, by which I mean any form of personal attack is absolutely out. Obviously, questioning, even firm questioning of ideas, is firmly permissible. What will then happen is that the person to whom the question is directed will be given a reasonable time for response. Ask them to be as succinct as they can be, they'll be asked to wind up if they are not being succinct. And there will then be an opportunity for the opposing team to provide a short response. Those are the rules of engagements. So, people within the audience who may wish to ask questions, could I invite you to begin to come down whenever you would like to, and take direction from the organisers to my left. The first question for the negative team from the affirmative team is this. Asexual reproduction gives up to twice as much reproductive success for the same resources as sexual reproduction. How could sexual reproduction ever gain advantage to be selected? And how could mere physics and chemistry invent the complementary apparatuses needed at the same time when non-intelligent processes cannot plan for the future coordination of male and female organs? That's the question. Could we throw to the negative team for a response?
Is that on?
Yep.
So this is actually an interesting one. I've looked into this. There are two sexes in most organisms. There's the whip-tailed lizard, actually, that changes back and forth. But I think the question you're kind of asking is why would sex evolve? And it actually, we know the answer to that. It increases genetic entropy. It actually has more likelihood of there being a success passed on, more likelihood of there being a fault passed on. There's actually a bacterial being that has seven sexes, which, interestingly enough, they can have sex with each other, and that also increases their genetic entropy, so there's more likelihood of there being a successful gene passed on, basically, is the answer to that, I guess.
All right. Now, would the affirmative team like to make a response to what's been said? I'm sorry?
Is this on? Ah, good. Yes, I'd just like to respond. I think what you're answering there is, Morgan, is why, but the question was how. the initial implied organism would have been a single-celled living organism capable of reproduction asexually. So somehow or other, between then and now, we have developed sexual reproduction. So the question relates to how.
Yes, Morgan?
Well, it probably happened early in life's development. We don't know. We are able to say those words, I guess, that we don't know occasionally. Some procreate differently than we do. And obviously there have been different evolutionary chains. As you probably know, there's the Y chromosome in humans and the X chromosome in all mammals, but there's the W chromosome in snakes and lizards. And as I mentioned earlier, the whiptail lizard actually doesn't have that W chromosome anymore to designate male. It just decides, or eventually, when it gets old enough, it becomes a male. It's female for the rest of its life. So it was just probably a random mutation that caused the seven sexes in the bacteria and caused the two sexes in the bacteria that just luckily enough ended up to be us. It's easier to organise two sexes, obviously, than it is to organise seven, and that two gives you a little bit better chance of there being genetic mutations passed on.
But once again, that answered when, but not how.
So I think I did answer how by saying genetic mutation.
But a mutation cannot lead to the incredible complexity of all the genetic information required to make male and female reproductive organs, which would have presumably taken millions of years to evolve, whilst asexual reproduction was still successfully continuing. So the question was how?
You don't know how either. Like, you say God did it. How did God do it? What was the exact process that God used to do that? Did he do this part first and then this part first and this part? Like, you don't have any record of how God did it. We don't have any record of how it evolved because microorganisms eat each other. So bacteria ate the evidence, basically. So it might be that we can never know. But I'm quite comfortable with that, not knowing.
I guess what I'm pointing out is the impossibility of the naturalistic explanation for origins to count for sexual reproduction. And in fact, when you read the eyewitness account of history, it says that God created us at the beginning, male and female, which makes enormous sense because there is no other way in which those things could have just happened by naturalistic processes. So if naturalistic processes are impossible, that leads you to the conclusion that there must have been a creator God.
Mark, again, you told us why, but the question was how.
All right. Now I'll move to the next question. My colleague, the doctor, tells me that was a good answer. Could I move to the next question? The question for the affirmative team is this. Paul of Tarsus outlawed prostitution in 1 Corinthians 6:16 when prostitution was widespread. Why didn't he outlaw slavery since it was similarly widespread?
To answer this question, I'd just like to go back into the Old Testament because Nick did raise that up. And I think this is a really important issue in the Bible, a whole issue of slavery. It's interesting that the Ten Commandments actually commences with the introduction, "I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery." And so effectively, the very foundation of this morality is that God is freeing us from slavery. In particular, he's talking to the Israelites. And God would often remind the Hebrew nation that they'd once been enslaved and that he'd redeemed them out of this house of slavery. And he demonstrates that in the ancient Near East, slavery was a very common practice. But often when we think of slavery in the Old Testament, we think of African-American slaves being kidnapped and shipped across the Atlantic to the southern states of USA. However, in the Old Testament, it's much better described as what we'd call indentured servanthood, or actually more like employees of today. So what would happen was that a person might be in economical difficulties and they might need the economic support, the funding support. And what they would do is they would literally hire themselves out to a landowner or some other kind of person who would be able to provide them with work. Now, the Old Testament actually had laws that protected these indentured servants. So every seventh year, the Hebrew slave owners were to free all of their indentured servants and let them go free. So, and also the laws that we have in the Old Testament is that kidnapping people and selling them into slavery was forbidden, and that Israelites were actually to protect runaway foreign slaves. So we have actually here, as Paul Copeland says, though Israel's laws on servitude wasn't the moral ideal, they show far greater moral sensitivity than other ancient Near Eastern texts. In doing so, they point us back to God's ideal at the beginning. All humans are God's image bearers. Now, when we move to the New Testament, which is where the question came from, we find Jesus giving his ministry mandate. It's an incredible ministry. It says, "The servant of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed." So literally Jesus' ministry was to set slaves free. And it's incredible. Now, Paul's description of the Christian community was this: there's neither Jew nor Greek, there's neither slave nor free, there's no male or female, for you're all one in Jesus Christ, which is an incredible vision of humanity. Now, the issue, of course, is why didn't Paul condemn slavery in the New Testament? Well, the issue is that in Rome, 85 to 90% of Roman society were slaves. And this would have, if all of them were free, literally Rome would have ended in chaos. And Rome would have swiftly and powerfully come in to abolish such an uprising. Instead, what the Bible did is it sowed the seeds of ultimate abolition of slavery by providing us an example of radically different community structure.
Now, we do need to be careful. That answer, of course, was significantly over time. I think, in fairness to the negative team, I'll allow them extra time now to respond. But we do need to try and keep the answers concise and directed to the question. So, the negative team.
A brief response. The word to Corinthianize in the Greek context meant to commit fornication. And so prostitution was widespread in Corinth when Paul of Tarsus decided to outlaw it in 1 Corinthians. So it seems that God is only partly able to set out his objective morality sometimes, but other parts of the Bible that are supposedly inspired seem to be up to humans and human interpretation, which at times has gone against the financial incentives of slave owners, and that's actually been a struggle for Christians to go and say that. One brief comment on the year of Jubilee. In Exodus 21, the book that starts with the Israelite people being taken out of slavery, it starts talking about Hebrew servants. It says, if you buy a Hebrew servant, he is to serve you for 6 years, but in the seventh year he will go free without paying anything. Now, critically, it goes on in verse 5 to say, if the servant should declare, I love my master, my wife, my children, I will not go out free. That is, if he has children and a wife, the slave owner is to take him to some judges, pierce his ear against a door, and he will serve forever. That's his entire life. So the year of Jubilee sounds like a good concession, but for any man who loves his wife, it doesn't seem to provide the concession of his own freedom. I'd argue that's immoral. Also, one other comment is, in the time of Exodus, back in Exodus 12, verse 44, it says, everyone's servant who is bought for money after you've circumcised him may eat of the Passover meal. So the very significant festival of Passover that was meant to symbolize the Jews being freed, the Israelites being freed from slavery under Egypt, is being allowed to the servants. So it seems rather insidious that they go from being slaves to now being slave masters. It really seems like they lack human empathy in that regard. Thanks.
All right. Now, the next question, this being a question for the negative team, why are you confident that the human mind is reliable in formulating accurate beliefs in areas far removed from our basic needs, such as cosmology, molecular biology, theoretical particle physics, and so on, and metaphysical realities, since our beliefs in those areas do not affect our survival in the immediate physical environment we find ourselves in?
So, is that on? Okay. So the question is, how did the we evolve such big brains, or
no? The question is why. The question is, why are you confident that the mind is reliable in formulating accurate beliefs in cosmology, etc.?
Okay.
Since these areas don't affect our survival in the immediate physical environment.
Well, the short answer to that is they're not. Our minds aren't very reliable with these things. There are ways to get around the tendency of the human mind to form false beliefs, to jump to false conclusions, outlined in the various scientific methods that have been used throughout history, ways of double-blind testing so that the experimenter doesn't influence the results themselves. So there's ways of thinking about things which we've discovered that allows us to think more rationally and objectively, and that is what has allowed us to do that, I would argue, rather than what I would pose as a counter question is why our brains are so irrational if they were designed. I mean, if God, that would to me seem a really poor design flaw. Why is emotion so forefront in our thinking? Why do we keep jumping to false conclusions? If God designed us, surely He'd design us to be rational first.
All right, a response, please, from the affirmative team.
Yeah, really appreciate your response there. I guess the challenge that we have, of course, is that if we are on the whole quite rational in our thinking, this would undermine most, if not all, of science, or a lot of science. So that's a major issue. So effectively, we're pulling the foundation out of science itself. I guess the other major issue that I have is that that basically we've had some arguments put forward here tonight for reasons why we shouldn't believe in God, but then we've also had the reason that we're basically irrational. So on one hand, we're irrational, but we need to go home and actually think about how we can decide what's true. So there's a great problem here that we can't actually achieve the end that is being recommended. Now, if God does exist and that we've been made in His image, then we have reason to trust our thinking on the whole. And so it's not a case of being irrational. So we can trust, you know, the majority of science. We can trust our thinking process. We can go away and think about what's true and come to real conclusions. We can conclude that the gods of Zeus are false gods. And we can also come to the conclusion that the God of the Bible is the true God. So I put forward to you that the irrationality of the mind is much better based on the God of the Bible.
Now, it occurs to me that there might be a question that at least I'd like to ask of both teams that arises out of that question, and I'd be interested in both of your perspectives on it. Would it even be accurate to describe a scientific theory in cosmology or theoretical particle physics or something of the sort like that as a belief? Now, I wonder if people have thoughts about that.
Well, I'm happy to say something. It's quite fascinating that our mind actually seems capable of discerning the laws of physics and chemistry, and that's really a remarkable thing. And Paul Davies has commented along those lines. So whether or not it's a theory or a belief, I guess depends on your presupposition. But if you assume that the mind is rational, and depending on the evidence, then we develop a theory. And often for scientists, they can believe certain things because it's their pet theory, but it doesn't mean that it's necessarily been established in that case. And there's a lot of areas like that, you know, Stephen Hawking and so forth have put forward a lot of these sort of theories.
And the affirmative team?
I actually wanted to quote Richard Feynman, if you understand quantum mechanics, you don't understand quantum mechanics. you need a lot of minds, and you too should probably know this, being that you work in science, to collaborate, to come to any real conclusion. You can't just do it on your own. Newton did it on his own, but he was probably a special case. And even then, he didn't always do it well on his own. He did sort of go down the route of alchemy and other things, which we now know is patently false. There are other issues with, I guess, the statement that we are infallible beings. We are, and definitely. You will admit that.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. We are, so that means we are irrational because infallibility implies irrationality.
All right, thank you for that. Could I ask the next question directed to the affirmative team? How do you know that God doesn't live on Kolob as the Mormons believe?
Yeah, well, this is an interesting epistemological question, and that's the whole issue. How do we know? And so with regard to issues regarding God, in my view, the only way that we can know is by revelation. So we have evidence from the existence of the world and so forth that I've presented, that there's this conclusion that there must have been something else beyond us. But the other side of it is that we have a revelation through the Bible. Now, why can we trust the Bible? In my view, there are two reasons for this. One is that the Bible records some records of God speaking to people that revealed the future, and those prophecies were fulfilled. And from the research that I've done, there's historical evidence that those prophecies were written well before they occurred, and they were fulfilled later. In detail, and indeed cyclopedias and studies have been made on this. The other thing is the historical accuracy as we check the archaeological evidence. So where we can check the history, there's very good alignment. So again, I published in this area a book titled Unwrapping the Pharaohs, How Egyptian Archaeology Confirms the Biblical Timeline. So I believe that there is this evidence there, very, very strong evidence that the revelation in the Bible is in actual fact a revelation of God. But that I know of no other way that we can know where God lives.
All right. So revelation and trust of the Bible, what does the negative team say to that?
A few comments on that. So with some things like the Exodus, we seem to find a growing number of scholars who are Old Testament minimalists who see fairly little or no archaeological evidence for the existence of this widespread exodus. And in fact, looking at Egypt, which is one of Professor Ashton's interest areas, it seems that nearly all of the workers who were building the pyramids and making bricks for mastabas in some of these construction projects were paid workers. And in fact, one of the, I forget his name, but one of the chief architects was buried with several other architects inside several of the necropolises. There's graves built for the architects because the workers were seen as honourable people who were building up the posterity of the pharaohs. In one part of Ezekiel, in chapter 26, we see a prophecy of the destruction.
Could you hold the microphone closer to your face, please?
In chapter 26 of Ezekiel, we see a prophecy of the destruction of Tyre. It says that the entire rock will be wiped clean, the debris will be smashed off it, and nets will be cast over the entire area where the port used to be. Now, if you look up the city of Tyre in a Google image search, you'll see beautiful beaches, a lovely port, a great little Lebanese city. And so it seems like some of this prophecy isn't actually necessarily trustworthy. And so, you know, Kolob, if Joseph Smith comes along and he was a convicted con man, he comes along and says that he has these tablets, it doesn't really sound like that's necessarily that much more trustworthy or less trustworthy to me.
Yes, but keep it quick. We've got a lot of people.
Okay. My understanding from history is that when the people fled from Tyre to the island just offshore when Alexander the Great was approaching, and that he demolished the city to build a causeway out to take the island, and it was essentially scraped bare by his men. So.
All right. Thank you. Now, we'll move to questions from the audience. Given that we have run over on that section of questioning between the two teams, what I'd like to propose is that each team gets only 1 minute to respond in the interests of trying to get through the long line of people that are waiting. So could I invite our first questioner to come forth? and ask away.
Good evening. Question for our atheist friends. You mentioned about the Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If I say my car is white, I'm giving a description of my car, not a definition of my car. My car is a travelling machine, I suppose, a transportation device. It seems to me when the Bible says the faith is substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, it's giving a description of faith, not a definition of faith. Could you possibly have misunderstood what the Bible is saying here? Please comment.
Sure. Obviously, that's not the only thing that faith is in the Bible. It also says that if you have faith as mustard seed, you can say to a mountain, chuck yourself in the ocean, and it will. I don't see many mountains chucking themselves in the ocean, so did Christians just not test this out? There are different definitions of faith. There's different sorts of faith. What I'm talking about is the faith that we get to when you shoot down every argument a Christian has, and at the end of it, they turn around and say, oh, it's just faith. I just know because of faith, and you can't touch that. That's the faith I was talking about, the evidence of things not seen.
The affirmative team. Again, 1 minute.
I think we all exercise faith in a wide variety of ways in every aspect of our lives. Even to trivial things like you sit down on a chair and you expect it to hold you because your experience has shown that thousands of times you've done this and it supports you. So we do actually live by faith all the time in all kinds of small ways. So the question really is, does the evidence support what we have placed our faith in? And my contention as a Christian is that the evidence indeed does support where I have put my faith. It always takes faith. You guys are exercising faith tonight in saying there's no God. I'm exercising faith in saying there is. But I think my position is stronger because the evidence that I see in the world around me supports the historicity of the biblical record and supports what I believe and what I read, which is revealed to me through the Bible.
Okay, my question is for our atheists. Thank you for pointing out that people do indeed trust doctors who work in mysterious ways. As someone who works in the medical field, I know that lots of people have no idea how doctors work, and to them it's mysterious. So my question is, how do you explain irreducible complexity? The human body, for instance, there are so many different systems, respiratory, reproductive, digestive, that are all interrelated, all codependent, the exception being reproductive. Without any of those working properly, you're either really ill or you're dead. So how do you explain that?
Okay, this is an example of, we've heard dozens of times tonight, it doesn't have a very flattering name. It's called an argument from ignorance. It is a known logical fallacy. Basically it goes, we don't know, therefore God. Or we don't know, therefore this. Just because you don't know how something evolved doesn't mean it didn't evolve. Just because you can't imagine how something happened doesn't mean that it has to be designed by God. It gives no evidence for God just because your imagination can't extend to how it happened, or just because we don't know. If you don't know something, you say, I don't know that. You don't say, I don't know, okay, God must have done it.
The affirmative team.
That has a colloquial name called God of the Gaps, kind of a belief. But in fact, it isn't that at all, and as both myself and John have illustrated in our presentations, we believe what we believe because of the evidence, not in spite of the evidence. So it's not a question of what we don't know. We believe these things because we do know them. So the question was about irreducible complexity. And fundamentally, it says that in almost any area of a living organism, there are relationships which must all be in place simultaneously, initially, for that to have any effect or to be of benefit or for the organism, in fact, to even live. And that mitigates powerfully against naturalistic explanations of origins, which can only happen through random processes, and there is no known evidence that shows all of those things could happen all at once. The probabilities are staggeringly against that.
Our next questioner.
My question is for the affirmative team. The Abrahamic God is frequently described as being omnipotent, omniscient, all-loving, eternal, ineffable, and unchanging, and unknowable. If the Abrahamic God is unknowable, how do we know that it's created the universe, that it is omnipotent, omniscient? How do we know anything at all about this Abrahamic God if it is in fact unknowable? And if we do know these other things about it, then it in fact is knowable.
It's a good question. I think the thing is, of course, that that's a little bit of a misrepresentation of the Abrahamic God, because the Bible says that God is knowable and that he has revealed himself to us. Now, certainly there might be aspects of God that are beyond our knowledge or beyond our ability to comprehend. That's fine. That's the whole definition of what God is. He's a transcendent. But he is able, as the Bible says, to reveal himself. If he is a person, if he's an agent, he can reveal aspects of his existence to us. And that's what he has done in the Bible through the life of Jesus and the resurrection. So this concept of God being unknowable is actually not a biblical idea.
Could I invite the negative team to respond?
How do you know? And how do you know how the person who wrote those things about God knew? Surely they're a person just like you and I. Surely they have no special powers of talking to God more than you or I. So when you go back to Bible writers, how do you know how they knew? You're trusting in their epistemology to say God is this. You can be pretty sure it's not as thorough as ours is in the modern world. So why would you trust the epistemology of ancient people to describe God for you? It makes no sense.
Thank you. Next questioner.
One thing I'd just like to say is, in the New Testament, one of the things I absolutely love about Jesus Christ is that he preached about love. It's all about love and acceptance. Now, a question I do have on this topic is on the topic of ethics and objective morality.
And a question for which team?
I would like to start with the affirmative, if that's okay. Mm-hmm. What is objective morality? And if objective morality does exist, what is the point of empathy? If these two concepts coexist within our minds, is objective morality empathy? If these two concepts are not the same and coexist, then what is the point of empathy? So my question is, if we have objective morality, why do we have this God-given gift of empathy?
The affirmative team?
Basically, from the Christian biblical perspective, is that morality is not independent from God, neither is it arbitrary, as Nick started off by pointing out in his presentation. Basically, morality is grounded in the goodness of God. So it flows out of his goodness and his love for all of us, and that's why we can be confident that it's objective. It's ontologically founded in him. Now, in terms of empathy, the fact is that empathy and love is something that just flows from God's nature. So we can have both morality, objective morality, coming from the nature of God, and also empathy as well. So I don't see any inconsistency in these two ideas.
And the negative term?
So we're fairly sure, based on evolutionary psychology, that empathy is necessary for the survival
of any type of herd. We actually see this in dogs fairly frequently. There was recently one in, or sorry, last year in China, a dog crossing the road got hit. Another dog on the other side of the road, no possible relation, I don't think, actually ran out into traffic to try and save the dog. It then ran away and they actually tried to find it because they wanted to interview it. But anyway, rather humorous. And we do see it in other animals as well. We see it in higher apes. They show empathy as well. Empathy does seem to be something that evolves for animals that are pack animals, such as ourselves, I guess, and animals that have communities.
But I don't think you've mentioned objective reality in responding to the question.
Objective morality, I don't think there is objective morality. There's fish that, well, if you look at the angler fish, the male actually has to rape the female to have babies. There's no objective morality, unfortunately. We see that as wrong. They don't survive if they don't do it.
Next question.
This is addressed to Dr. Harwood. You state that we now live in the imperfect remains of a perfect creation. However, in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, St. Paul says, "Ever since the creation of the world, his invisible nature, namely his eternal power and deity, have been clearly perceived in the things that have been made." So according to St. Peter, we do still have at least perceptual access to God's imperceptible nature in all created things. My question then to you is, as a demonstration of God's existence, how do you recognize a perfect transcendent God in a fallen, imperfect, immanent creation? For example, can you describe the ontological relationship between God and something like genetic entropy? How are they ontologically compatible?
Okay, so Paul says this in Romans 1:20, and basically his point is that there is sufficient information available to us by observation of the world around us such that man is without excuse in terms of his knowledge of the existence of God and God's divine qualities. But it doesn't allow us to see everything about God simply because the world is a fallen, broken world. We see it's full of suffering, for instance, which has been raised a couple of times tonight. So our real understanding, therefore, our more complete understanding, comes from God's specific revelation of himself in his word. And as I mentioned right at the beginning of my talk, we can have confidence that his word is in fact the truth, the eyewitness account from the very beginning of all of history. So we can't learn all there is to know about God from observing the world, but we can discover that there is one, and man is without excuse, but it's from his specific revelation that we discover more of him.
Could I invite the negative team to respond?
So I actually think I addressed this in my talk. If we live in a fallen world, then God knew about Eve, that Eve was going to cause the fall. He could have stopped it. Any parent in the audience would stop their child from sticking their finger in a PowerPoint. Not stopping that is a heinous act, and you claim that God did that. So you are claiming that God is evil.
Well, I will allow a response to that. I noticed that you haven't used all your time, and perhaps we'll... Hold on. Hear me out, because I'll come back to you.
In 30 seconds... God warned Adam of the consequences of his actions. We overlook so often that God made us in his image, meaning that we are free moral agents, we were made for relationship with him, and that is only possible if we have volition. So if you were pre-programmed so that you could do nothing but worship and love God, you could not be in meaningful relationship with him. So it had to be possible for Adam to rebel, but it was also possible for Adam not to rebel. So the fact that we're made in God's image is something that God has never violated. He's never gone back and reached in and just fixed everything up arbitrarily.
And could I offer you another 30 seconds, please?
Made in God's image, are we invisible? I don't even know what that means. And I defy you to know what that means either. Hang on, what was the question? Okay, the tree was of the knowledge of good and evil. So if they hadn't eaten from the tree, how could they know that they shouldn't eat from the tree? If they don't know that it's wrong to eat from the tree before they do that, then...
I think the former speaker said
they
something.
They did, because God told them. He warned them as a loving father.
But how could they know that it's wrong?
Because God warned them as a loving father would warn his child.
All right.
Okay.
All right. I'm I'm deeply tempted to ask about the existence of Adam. There are many Christians who would accept that Adam never existed at all. And I'm curious as to what the affirmative team would say to that.
Well, I mean, that's what the Bible says as a revealed word, and it's very consistent with a lot of science that we have. I think it's a very logical explanation. Creation has to have occurred in a very, very short period of time because of ecological problems that we have. So, to me, the biblical account it fits the evidence that we have very well. Short time span, God created people. And so, name, Adam, yeah.
And again, I'm diverting things, but could I ask the negative to respond briefly?
I think it's only a short time span because you want it to be a short time span, but anyway. What was the other bit you said? Sorry, I missed the other bit you said. The existence of Adam. So, yeah, there are a lot of religions that don't agree with the existence of Adam. If Noah's Ark existed, was it 4,000 years ago? Then all species would have had to have fit on that, and it's just not possible unless you accept some evolution from that point. And there's not enough time to do that, so we've got a problem with your hypothesis, right, which isn't a theory, but hypothesis.
I didn't want to divert things from our audience speakers. Could I invite the next questioner?
Thank you to both teams. It's been a really thought-provoking discussion tonight. My question is to our atheist friends. Do you believe that it's logical to risk your life to save a stranger? And if you do believe that it is logical, then how does naturalism and survival of the fittest fit in with that? And if you don't believe that it's logical, then do you believe in the existence of completely selfless love, and can you account for it? Sorry, that was a long question.
That's a good question. The negative team?
So we see throughout the animal kingdom there's altruism in higher primates, and part of the human brain and the brain of higher primates is that they're actually able to model the behaviour and the actions and the emotional states of other people. So if one person starts yawning, many other people start yawning. If you show bonobos a video of a human yawning, they start yawning. So the interesting thing is emotional transmission through to different people, our pro-social behaviour does have evolutionary roots, and it's a very big problem in the world of, mirror neurons show us that we have the ability to model other people's behaviour in order to learn from them. The interesting thing is they put a monkey in a MRI machine, and if a human comes in and starts opening up a peanut and shelling it, the monkey starts lighting up the same neurons in the way that they would if they were actually shelling the peanut. So seeing another person's behaviour lets even monkeys and groups from different species be able to model our own behaviour, and that's a big part of altruism.
The affirmative team.
Well, I think that you know, animals were actually made to be our friends and to bring pleasure to us, the whole world originally in this sense, in terms of this. So obviously they would have certain characteristics. But I think the ability to give your life for someone else stems from a God-given love, really, that everybody has. Just like everybody has a conscience, some people deny that, and I think, see, this is part of the image of God in us, thankfully.
Well, I see that someone wants to ask a question. Keep it very short.
I take some umbrage with animals were made for our pleasure. You know, you realise that there are animals that burrow out of people's eyes. There are diseases. There are pathogens. I'm sure there's actually some medical people in the audience who will talk about some animals.
Yeah, okay. I said they were made that way, but sin has then had its plan from that way. It's fallen world.
How
so that's
do you
my,
know?
My view of it.
How do you know?
All right. Could I ask our next questioner?
Thank you. Two brief points for the affirmative team. Secular attestations of Jesus are often used to avoid the circular reasoning of using the Gospels for the existence of Jesus. That's valid to the extent that sign of the four is evidence for Sherlock Holmes' existence, but anyway. How do you respond to that? And the issues with the secular attestations are well known, so why do they continue to get raised? The Josephus passage looks to be an interpolation since it breaks up the narrative. The Tacitus passage is too late not to be influenced by preaching, and the Suetonius passage is in the wrong life. If this is going to agree with the 33 date, it should be in the life of Tiberius, and it's in the life of Claudius. Excuse me. So how do you respond to that? There are multiple issues with those, so why do you continue to raise them as evidence?
So basically what we're looking at here is how do we determine what is historical? And for this issue, we need to approach it like an ancient historian would. And what we have here is any historian would be looking for the source of information about a person or event, and then actually determining, constructing the best explanation for that event as well. And so what we have here is a number of different testimonies about the life of Jesus. We have the letters which refer to Jesus as well. And we also have the external evidence from Josephus and Tacitus just mentioned as well. The issue here, of course, is that, you know, the historian can construct what actually happened based on that information. And it's basically impossible for historians to do their work if they have this fundamental skepticism with all of the sources that they have. So Time. Basically they need to approach their work from a historical perspective.
Okay, Josephus was 95 CE, and it's not even clear that he was referring to Jesus of Nazareth. And even if he was, it's hearsay. He's heard it from a Christian, and he's writing about what he's heard. It's not evidence. I don't even know where to start with this. I've got a video on YouTube, which is on Sydney Atheist Channel, which addresses all the historicity claims, but basically Paul was the first New Testament writer, never wrote about a historical Jesus, never mentions a historical Jesus, never quotes Jesus once, his supposed saviour, never talks about any events in the life of Jesus. Sorry, was that time?
No, you've got 20 seconds okay. Before we go to the wrap-up.
If he's the first, and he even says about the Eucharist, the beginning of the of you know, breaking the bread and the wine and everything, he says that he received it from revelation, not that it was a practice among Christians at the time. None of this makes any sense if Jesus was a historical figure.
All right. Thank you. We have run out of time for more Q&A, which is a great pity because there were a long line of people who wished to ask some questions. Could we move now to the five-minute closing statements and invite the affirmative team to give a five-minute closing statement.
In tonight's debate, it is clear the question of whether God exists or not is something of significant interest and importance. Of course, you're here tonight to prove that or demonstrate that point, I should say. If God does not exist, then life has no ultimate meaning, purpose, or hope. Life will end individually for us all at our own death and universally at the death of the universe. There'll be no ultimate justice for any injustices, crimes, or moral monstrosities that have been committed. Ultimately, everything will end in nothing. However, if God does exist, then we have the wonderful opportunity to build a relationship with the creator of the universe and consequently to have a confidence of being resurrected from the dead to experience eternal life with him. Thus, whether God exists or not is tremendously significant for each one of us personally. Tonight we've been exploring the evidence for whether God actually exists, and the atheist team invited us to follow the evidence where it leads. And our Christian team has presented five key reasons for believing in God. The first reason comes from the origin of the universe. The beginning of the universe points towards an immaterial, uncaused, enormously powerful and personal creator of the universe. And basically, we haven't really heard any alternative concept from the atheist side on that point. The second reason for the existence of God is from the origin of life itself and the existence of coded information in DNA, for which there is no conceivable naturalistic explanation. Any argument that assumes a naturalistic explanation is really just an evolution of the gaps argument. Thirdly, we have identified that the human mind, which includes consciousness and rationality, provides evidence for the existence of God as our intelligent creator. If our cognitive faculties were produced by naturalistic evolution, then we have very little reason to trust our own cognitive faculties in areas that bear little to survival, just like metaphysical beliefs. And the atheist team agreed on this point. Hence, naturalistic evolution is self-refuting. Thus, our own rationality provides strong evidence for the existence of God, and it is actually irrational to hold the atheistic position. Fourthly, the existence of objective moral values and duties point towards the existence of God as the ontological foundation, the grounds of morality. And here the atheists agree with us that if God does not exist, then there are no objective moral values and duties. But the fact is that love and compassion and tolerance are genuinely good. And to hold a young girl in a dungeon for 10 years and sexually abuse her is truly evil. To gang rape a woman is truly evil. So, you know, all of the moral issues that the atheists have raised, such as the problem of evil and any apparent difficulty with Old Testament morality, requires an objective morality to critique it. So to ensure that the issue is not just groundless. Hence, these issues have been raised by atheists are actually, as I said before, backhanded evidence for the existence of God. Finally, the historical evidence for the resurrection of Jesus points directly to the existence of God. The atheist contentions that the New Testament accounts are simply mythical constructions from pagan mystery religions or are not historically reliable go against all of the conclusions of the majority of respected ancient historians. And here we had affirmed that the Gospel of Mark was produced within 30 years of Jesus' death and resurrection. And we have Paul as well, who wrote his letters within 17 years, within 20 years. Instead of the resurrection of Jesus is the best explanation for the historical facts that we observed. I'd like to conclude our presentation tonight by highlighting the reality that God is not just an idea, but a person who's chosen to reveal himself to us through Jesus Christ. Having presented to you substantial evidence that God does exist, I would like to invite you to read through one of the Gospels, accounts of the life of Jesus, and ask yourself, could it be true that the God revealed in the life of Jesus is a person who's able to give me hope, meaning and purpose for my life right now and the promises of eternal life? I know that some of you here tonight may have been hurt by religion, but I would like to point out that Jesus himself was hunted down and crucified by the religious leaders of his day. I invite you not to explore human religion, but the person of Jesus Christ. My life has been transformed by Jesus, and I invite you to experience the difference that Jesus can make in your life.
And could I invite the negative team to present their concluding remarks?
I'm sorry, none of us got round to preparing one, so this is going to be pretty random. Now, we haven't heard a single shred of evidence. We've heard supposedly five reasons, but they haven't given us any evidence. Until there's evidence, surely there's no reason to accept the existence of something. Now, first reason that they gave was if there's no God, then there's no ultimate meaning or justice or anything. So, that's wishful thinking. If there was, then this would be good, and we want this, so therefore God must exist because that's what we want to happen. That is wishful thinking, nothing more. Now, you talk about the origins of life, the origins of the universe. We can't explain it, therefore God must exist because he must have done it. God, saying that God did it adds nothing to our understanding. How did God do it? Why did God do it? When did God do it? If there's a stage and something magically appears on the stage, we can all look at it and say, that's magic. Why does it make it any more or less explicable if there's a magician on the stage? Magic has happened. It makes no sense. Adding a magician doesn't add anything to our understanding of what has occurred. The rational mind argument, that we have rational minds, we have minds that are somehow capable of rationality. I wouldn't say that we have rational minds, and I think that that serves as more of an indictment on the affirmative team's case than on ours, that we don't have rational minds, that we have minds that evolve imperfectly. Objective morality, I actually disagree with Morgan here. I think there is such a thing as objective morality. It depends how you define the morality, though. If you define good as human flourishing, then you can quite easily say that something is objectively good or objectively bad. And you don't need any concept of God in order to do that. You can use science to do that. Now, talking about the majority of biblical scholars saying that Jesus existed, the majority of biblical scholars are Christians. So, of course, they're going to say that Jesus existed. Now, in terms of ancient historians take the view that if something is written about someone in ancient history, then it is more logical to just assume that person existed, because thousands of people existed in ancient times that we have nothing written about. That is the strength of the case for the existence of Jesus in ancient times. That's pretty much it. The Bible actually has more evidence against the existence of Jesus. Once we understand when each book was written and who it was written by, it shows that the only way to make sense of the Bible and how it was written is to say that Jesus didn't exist. That the idea of a historical Jesus was invented by Mark, the first gospel writer. We know from studying the Bible that Matthew copied from Mark, and so did Luke, and John was so far after that you know, he had no access to eyewitnesses or anything anyway. That's about it, isn't it? Have we got any other? No. Thank you.
Just two minor housekeeping announcements. The first is there'll be some refreshments outside here at the conclusion of this evening. The second is, not expecting the caterers would be late, I understand the Sydney Atheists have organised a get-together at the Cabana Bar, Christie Street, St Leonard's, a little later this evening. Those two housekeeping matters said, the time comes to formally wrap up the debate. Firstly, I hope that all who have been listening, or at least that some who have been listening, whether here in the audience or online, have found something thought-provoking in what has been said, what has been exchanged between these two teams. Once again, I'd like to thank all of the people who organised this evening and the great turnout that we had. Could you put your hands together for them? And could you also put your hands together to our debaters? And thank you. That's the conclusion of proceedings this evening.